A vast constellation of clarification has arisen for me this morning. What do you do in those instances? Because it'll happen to you for sure. Remain sober. Remain in the mood of repentance. Even somber. So don't get all bubbly. You know. So these are just the tips, because invariably constellations of clarification will arise for you. Invariably. So when you get practice this mood of repentance, how did it happen? Got up in the morning, my mind was all over the place, and I said, oh yeah, I only have one problem, it's the continuity problem. I kept saying that. The whole thing sort of centered in, and then from there, I was able to make these incredible changes of perspective. Very, very deep and heavy stuff. Even up to the point of realizing what seeing the now is all about, actually. Accepting the now as it is. And then I kind of shocked. I said, whoa, I'm here. And instead of frantically trying to hold on to it, rather focus on the mood of repentance, which is the inevitable shock of, hey, I'm here, I made it. The shock of, I made it, is enough to throw you off, of course. So the more that you can be in this sober mood of repentance, what I call repentance, of change of mind, and the aftershocks of this change of mind. They're aftershocks. There's the shock, and then there's all these aftershocks. You have to just let this process of aftershocks take place without trying to, you know, seize upon it. If you try to seize upon the moment like that, no, just remain non-celebratory, as it were. Don't try to celebrate. So these videos just sort of set an example of a general approach as to how do you handle success, really. I think the meta message here is, how do you handle success? Because you're going to be successful in a change of perspective. Everybody will eventually, for sure. So it's more about handling that. That's the most important thing. How to get centered. I say the continuity problem is the only problem we have, which really means, how do you handle this change of perspective? Because it seems very abrupt. Like, wow. The insights I had were like so iconoclastic that it just changed everything upside down. And how do you handle that? And this non-celebratory mood of repentance, sober. It's not like you pop the champagne corks, you know, when you see, oh my gosh, I now see what's going on. Don't pop the champagne corks. Don't send out the invitations to everybody. Because there's a shock. There's a shock, and there's aftershocks. There's a shock of realizing I've made it, and how could I have been so stupid, and lots of stuff. Lots of little aftershocks that you might feel glum afterwards. You know, you say, oh, I finally, you know, succeeded in seeing what the whole foolishness is all about. I made it. And then the aftershock is you feel really kind of glum. Say, why am I feeling down about that? So consciously allow the mood of repentance to set in. Because it will. It's going to happen anyway. The aftershocks are there. If you just try to plow through it, you're going to find out you get in a lot of trouble. If you just try to be, say, all right, I got it, everybody. No. I've got the aftershocks, is what I've got. So it may seem like you're going slow. You go, you're going fast. You're going fast. If you throw a party, that's when you're going to go slow. Because the aftershocks are still happening and they're affecting you. And at some point, you will have a continuity problem with your path, you know, if you do it that way. Whereas if you stay in the mood of repentance, you don't have a continuity problem with your path, with your, you know, what you're doing. It's you stay consistent. You stay consistent. So maybe the next time is that I will make a push. I'll be able to accept things, seeing things as they are right now. And maybe that will stay, or maybe not. Maybe it'll be a stronger sense of it, and then the aftershocks of that come. So we already know the answers. Everybody does. I went to sleep last night. I was lying there. I saw everything just as it is. I said, oh, you know, I already know all the answers. Always have known exactly how everything is, but. Still, there's this continuity problem we have, so that's what gets in the way. So you have to realize that. I think that's the major stumbling point that people have, and what I really want to impress upon everyone is this continuity problem, and the need to accept that it is a severe problem, and account for it. Because if we don't account for it, that's when the wheels come off and we waste our lives presuming that the breakthrough is going to come through any moment. But again, when the breakthrough happens, the shocks and aftershocks also happen from that. It's inevitable. So if you have been used to managing this properly and bit by bit by bit by bit by bit, you won't lose your patience, you won't come unglued, you won't get frustrated, you won't become inflated and all this various things. No, you'll stay in the mood of repentance and say, okay, I have a continuity problem. So acceptance that you do have this one problem, it doesn't mean that you don't know the truth, you do, but you have a continuity problem with dropping what? With dropping your defense of truth. Because what we've really been doing is we've been defending reality. But the question is, from what? Why does reality need to be defended? The fact is, it doesn't. And it doesn't need to be defended. But we have been what we're doing, our defense systems are really defending the now from changing, from not being the now, from becoming concrete. we're defending the ephemeralness from becoming concrete, and so we take a picture of it as if it were concrete. We concretize it in our imagination, we reify it, concretize it, the ephemeral, the ever-changing, more than that, just like clouds, ephemeralness of all appearances. We imagine it's concrete, so we can then figure out how to make it ephemeral, you know, how to protect it from this presumed threat that's going to turn it into stone, you know, turn pure spaciousness into stone, as it were. Turn all these ephemeral appearances in pure spaciousness into some sort of block of concrete. We think we're defending against that. We're trying to find a way to prevent it. So we kind of make this mock scenario in our mind, in our imagination, so we can work on it. But it really isn't there. And that's what I mean. Everybody knows that it's really not there. It's really something we've just a mock-up in our imagination, a mirage, as it were, of concretization, reification of what is not concrete, set in stone, as it were, and so we can work on it. But the problem is the continuity problem in setting that down, realizing it, we don't need it. We don't need this imagination. We can see things as they actually are right now without worrying about defending it from being something else. But we're so used to this mirage, this mock-up in our imagination, it seems too abrupt to set it down. That's the continuity problem. That's the continuity problem. Which is what makes most any explanation will seem paradoxical to you. If you are not aware of this continuity problem and not aware that you can speak from two different perspectives, from the actual ultimate perspective and then also from the continuity problem perspective. But if you are aware of the continuity problem, then all this speech, you know, this high spiritual teaching, that it doesn't seem paradoxical at all to you. Gone. I mean, there's no paradox at all. You just understand, yeah, that there is this continuity problem. Therefore, from that angle, everything seems a certain way. Okay. And we think we need enlightenment. Okay, from the absolute perspective of how things really are, there is no enlightenment. None whatsoever. What needs enlightenment in reality? What is it that needs? Nothing needs enlightenment. There's no enlightenment. Everything is always exactly as it is right now. So it's really, we need to drop the notion that something can be enlightened, because what we're really afraid of is that something can be changed from what it is right now. Right now can have some, be somehow something different outside of pure spaciousness. It cannot. So nothing is ever going to be enlightened. There is no enlightenment. This is from the absolute perspective. Now from the perspective of the continuity issue, you say, oh, wait, I need to be enlightened. What are you talking about? So, the real key is to understand this continuity problem and to accept it and to acknowledge it and allow it to be there and accept, okay, I'm going to have to, you know, this is my shadow, or this is something that's going to follow me along like this. When you do that, again, all these paradoxes, that they don't arise. You get it. And then you can talk very, very clearly and directly about the situation without being disturbed within yourself. I've seen that those who don't acknowledge a continuity problem, you know, freak out when you speak this way. Now, here's another thing you can say. There is no savior. There is no savior. What does reality need a savior from? For? Saving reality from what? There's nothing to save reality from. It's only our imagination that reality can be changed. It's not reality that doesn't have any problem. Our problem is that we can't change reality. And you can say, well, we need to be saved from that. But that too is not having any effect on reality. And we really only need to be saved from the continuity problem of setting this ridiculous whim down. So it's only a continuity problem that we need to work on. Now the ego claims to be our savior from the continuity problem. So when you talk here about savior and enlightenment and a master, so that's the ego. That is the ego. It's the ego that is advancing those notions. Whereas when you accept the mood of repentance, that is your salvation. That is how you get to salvation. That's how you get saved, by resolving the continuity problem. By bit by bit by bit, bit by bit by bit, the paradox dissolves and you realize there is no paradox. It's only a continuity problem. So I remember when I started out, I was like, wait a minute, this is all paradox. How do you resolve this paradox? And I was trying to do it, you know, mentally, conceptually. No, that's not it. It's when you accept there's a continuity problem, you accept the mood of repentance, and you know you have to let these aftershocks, like, wow, this incredible good fortune, and wow, how could I have been denying myself this beauty, incredible, how everything isn't right now, all from so many moments I've been denying myself, and I could have done it forever if I didn't wise up. All these things are shocks, aftershocks reverberating, so many aftershocks. You have to let those settle down. Let's say there's this rock in a pond. There's this beautiful pond, and it's all cloudy.
Okay.
It's all cloudy and choppy. And you look, what's going on? You reach down there, and you pull out a stone that's fizzing. It's like an Alka-Seltzer or cells or tablets. It's fizzing. It's causing the water to get all turbulent, and it's a muddy fizz. It's stirring everything up. Okay, you say, oh, and you realize, oh, there's a whole bunch of stones in this pool that are fizzing. And you say, wow, I got to get those stones out of there. So you reach down and you pull out the stone. But when you pull it out, that causes reverberation in the, you know, you've displaced something. And so the pool momentarily is choppy, even choppier. But then you just let it settle down. Just realize, okay, it was my action of removing this fizzy stone that brought this about. But I know there's less fizzy stones in there now. So if I just keep doing this, eventually I'll get all the fizzy stones out, and then the pool will be absolutely clear. But while I'm taking these stones out, it's going to cause choppiness. So as we recognize the situation, that causes temporary turbulence. This is how we resolve the continuity problem. Is the mood of repentance enables us to have the patience to don't freak out and say, ah, this pool's still choppy, you know. No, you expect it. Say, okay, a little turbulence. It's going to seem a little worse for a little while. Don't panic. It doesn't mean you didn't see clearly. It just means seeing clearly caused a shock. So like this morning, I saw so incredibly, through the whole thing, so incredibly clearly, but now I don't. Because now the shocks, you know, are reverberating. So don't doubt that, you know, that you did see it clearly. Don't doubt it. Just say, no, I did. I can get back there, even though it was a lot of work. I'll get back there, but just not right this moment. The shocks are still, you know, the turbulence is still there. And you may have pulled the last stone out, and the turbulence is really bad, and you think, oh, I don't understand anything. I failed. Oh, that's so terrible. And you can get really depressed if you don't see it as a continuity problem. I'm saying the mood of repentance, acknowledging you have a problem, the continuity problem, and accepting that you must have a mood of repentance to deal with that problem, that prevents depression. It prevents all sorts of disorders. If you don't have that and you try to go along the spiritual path, you're going to end up in depression, most likely. Because everybody, again, knows the truth. This is what I realized last night. We're all aware. We're all aware of it. But we also are totally accustomed to defending it. And we don't. It doesn't need any defense. Reality doesn't need any defense. So we have to drop this defense of reality, which is really, the other side of that is an attack upon reality. Because as long as we believe reality needs to be defended, that means we believe it can be attacked, which is ultimately what our desire is to attack reality, to get rid of it, so that we can be the creators of a new reality. We thought, hey, God created this, you know, this is a wonderful creation. Let's see if we can make our own wonderful creation. So again, to defend something is really to say that it can be attacked. But to say it doesn't need any defense is to say also there's nothing that can attack it. So admitting we have this big problem that does take the mood of repentance, it requires it, is the answer. It is the essential component of anyone's spiritual path. And of course, nobody likes to admit that, because they say, well, it's going to take me, you know, take me a while then. You know, I want to do it now, right now. Well, the quickest way is the mood of repentance. The way that is sure to work is classically in the Western Christian tradition, people are say, I am a sinner. They acknowledge that they have this fundamental block, some fundamental problem in relation to reality. They, you know, reify it, concretize it as a god or, you know, some kind of concretized something, image or whatever. But it's really the super matrix of pure, smooth spaciousness, the prime creator. Prime field of being. I have a problem. I have a block. There's some problem there. That's the first step. Then I need to be in a serious, sober, calm, patient. The whole thing about be tolerant, be forgiving, be patient with one another. Agape, have that patient. Really, agape is like be patient with one another. Not really love one another. It's be patient with one another. The term love has got way too many overtones of physicality and romance and all these kinds of things. But be patient with one another. It doesn't have those overtones. That's way better. In other words, allow the people in your environment their space to be reflective, to be in this mood of repentance, so they're not going to be entertaining you, you know. In other words, don't ask your brother to entertain you. Don't ask your brother to put on a show. Give them their time, space, let them be somber. Because if you're aware also of you, that you too have this continuity problem and you too need that, then you'll understand that it's a productive somberness, in that they're letting the aftershocks of realization of their great good fortune, that reality doesn't need to be defended, which means we can give up all this horrible reification and this mock-up, this concrete mock-up. We can be free of that. You know, we're free. We're, you know. We don't need to be enlightened. No one, nothing's ever going to be enlightened. No such thing as enlightenment. Really, it's freedom. Reality is freedom from enlightenment, because nothing needs to be enlightened. To say that something needs to be enlightened is to say something about reality needs to be changed. There's nothing needs to be changed. There's no one that is enlightened. That means, in other words, the now, how everything is right now, is always the way that it is. And there's no one seeing that. There's nothing, there's no I, a location of this being seen, which makes it somehow true. It doesn't need to be located to be true. Freedom doesn't have a location. It doesn't need to say, well, I am free. In this location, I am free. No. Because there's nowhere that reality isn't real. So, again, it's culture can help greatly bring us to this acceptance of freedom as it is. It's not my freedom, it's not your freedom, it's all freedom. Everything is free from any need to defend its freedom. That's freedom, right? If you have to defend your freedom, how is that freedom? You're not free from the defense of it. So you're not free. So again, as I've said many times, the culture, the world culture, is very important, actually. And I've also stated that the direction that this world is going into is a most decidedly very negative, very bad direction, which is really trying to wipe out the real aspiration. It's trying to get everybody to be giddily happy, entertaining everyone all the time, decorating everything, and pretending like they don't have a continuity problem. That's the ego's way. The ego's way is say, hey, you know, let's make this mock-up that we have imagined. Let's make it wonderful so we don't even need to worry about the continuity problem, because we're never going to set this mock-up down. Let's just make it permanent. That is what I call the fourth dimension. That is what we're going into right now. Very bad situation for those who want to drop this insane quest for enlightenment, actually. The quest for enlightenment is the problem, because really it means we're trying to be ultimately happy with this mirage, with the mock-up. Yet not realizing that it is a mock-up, and that that too abides in perfect freedom. So the truth is, no one's ever been enlightened. No one ever will be enlightened. That's the actual truth. The ego thinks that's all a paradox. It's not. To be enlightened means to change what is. Or to see, like, I see it. No, nobody, there's no location for seeing. I find it, you know, like we're, perception is to say that something is located, like I'm seeing this. I see, meaning this environment, what's around me, is being seen here, you see, is being seen here. It's located here. It's not located here. It doesn't have any location. So there is no one that is enlightened. There is no I am enlightened. It's really the giving up of enlightenment, realizing that nobody can be enlightened. There's no such thing. That brings freedom, relief. And then the ego claims that they're enlightened, which is not true. It's the opposite. They gave up the quest for enlightenment. They realized they don't need to defend against enlightenment. Because enlightenment is just another way of saying you think that something, somehow a change can happen to reality. It's an egoic concept. Enlightenment is an egoic concept, actually. And then this paradox seems to arise. If you don't handle the continuity issue and the mood of repentance, then these paradoxes arise and you get all confused. But instead of struggling with it, just feel the shock and the aftershock of it, and then you don't get into the paradox. There isn't any. You just realize that you're stunned, and you say, "That's the continuity issue. I feel stunned because of the continuity issue," and then you don't get into your mind about all these seeming paradoxes. Wait a minute. What did you say? No. You don't even get into it. Because, you see, if we don't accept the continuity problem in this mood of repentance, then the mind will say, wait a minute, if what you said is true, that there's no enlightenment, nothing will ever be enlightened, so we don't have to worry about it, any sort of change in reality, I should be happy now. And I don't feel happy because I feel all kind of stunned. So, you know, what you said I can't be true, but I feel it's true, but I don't feel happy, so what's this problem? And then your mind starts just going off and off and off on this. You see how that worked? And then you really end up going gone for maybe, who knows, days, weeks, months, years. You just get off track so easy. Get off track. But if you accept, this is stunned to me, so of course I'm not going to feel happy, enlightened, buoyant. I'm stunned by this. So just let this feeling gradually, the aftershocks gradually play out, then you don't have this conflict and you don't activate your thinking to try and figure something out. You already know what's going on, so why try to figure something else out? You don't have to. You say, okay, no, this is true, but I'm momentarily stunned by it. Then no activation of your mind. This is what I've discovered. I'm sharing what I've discovered. Because I used to be the way of the mind getting activated to say, hey, if this is true, I should be elated. And I'm not, so maybe it's not true, but I know it's true, but how can it, you know, and there's all this conflict, and your mind tries to then figure it out. Been there and done that. So, it's allowing this feeling of unhappiness, like it's part dismay. It's a mixture, you know. It's like part elation, part dismay, part uncertainty. It's just, whoa, it's like an earthquake. Kind of an inner earthquake. And you just let everything settle down, and there's aftershocks. And then gradually you're able then to get back to looking at it more carefully. But this time, you know, it doesn't cause. You say, it didn't cause that earthquake this time, because you've already kind of allowed that to play out. You've pulled that fizzing stone out of the pond. It's no longer in the pond. Now you're going after another one. But you got confidence. I can do that too, because no matter what I pull out of that pond, I'm going to be able to handle the shocks and the aftershocks without going all mental. Without going all mental. Because you can't go all the way. If you're going to go mental, you cannot do it. So at some point, you have to get into this mood of repentance and accept that you have a continuity problem. Otherwise, you'll get stuck. And you'll just be stuck going mental constantly, round and round and round and round, stressing out, not sleeping. I used to not be able to sleep at all. I had the most horrific problem with insomnia. It's just the worst thing ever. My mind was just racing, you know, a million miles a second, like constantly trying to figure out everything, and couldn't sleep, could never take a rest. Impossible for me. No matter, I could be so just completely dead, exhausted, and I could not rest because my mind was still just nonstop. I couldn't stop the mind. It's horrible, horrible. And those who have been there know what I'm talking about. And this was just the most severe type of situation. It went on for decades and decades. And now, I can like sit down to take a rest. I'm tired. I just lie down, and in a matter of a minute or so, very quickly, poof, out like light, sleep for 20 minutes, wake up, you know. I can take cat naps, you know, incredibly well, anywhere. I can seem to be able to fall asleep anywhere and take a rest. And I can sleep at night if I don't, you know, try to push things too hard. I can sleep at night. So it's a complete turnaround. And why? Because there's nothing going on mentally. Sort of, I'm accepting my unhappiness. I said, because I realize it's a stunned condition. I'm temporarily stunned. And so, of course, I'm not going to feel all light and carefree, no. And so there's nothing, thinking's not going to change it. So in other words, you identify what the problem is, then you realize, oh, it's just going to take a little bit of time. So it's like the wine in the Last Supper. It takes a little time to gain, you know, to gain its fullness. So you just say, okay, I'll just sleep on it and work again tomorrow, go to work tomorrow. You don't go to bed in a mood of trying to figure anything out. So you'll be amazed at how this will change your insomnia. It will change your depression. It won't make you feel wonderful. No. But you won't feel nearly as bad as before. So I never feel good. I never feel wonderful because I'm constantly going deeper and being stunned by it. Knowing that eventually that will pay off and everything will smooth out. But take one step at a time. And again, the problems of the path, you cannot go really far if you're still going mental. Cannot. It'll wipe you out. The problem is that this culture we have now in the world is designed to make you go mental. It's designed to, in such a way that you will stop the path because you're saying, well, I'm going too mental. I can't do that, so I better stop that. It's designed to not recognize that you have a continuity problem and not support the mood of repentance, which means you're going to have no choice but to go mental when you get to this place. And then you say, oh my gosh, then you say, you're going to be taught to say, that's bad, you need to get into having fun. So really, it is an attack on the whole spiritual path is what's taking place. As we saw with China and Tibet. Now, as far as who owns Tibet, that is something that has gone back and forth throughout, you know, for 1,000 years or more. So that's not the issue. The issue is, you know, what's going on is an attack upon the culture of spiritual aspiration is what it really was an attack on by secular materialists. Which is the mood. The United States and the whole world is turning into this one kind of communist world of worshiping secular materialistic consumerism. That's what it's all about. And so what you're taught is, hey, are you going mental? Buy something. Yeah, but how do you buy something? Go somewhere. How do you buy something? Well, you need money. Okay, go to work. Work harder. Work harder, make more money, buy something, okay? And we need this so-called social justice where we need to redistribute so we have this utopian, secular, humanistic utopia, right? That's Antichrist. It's Antichrist, totally. The fact that we have inequalities in the world, that is not Antichrist, not at all. Because the fact is that this situation, it enables you to be in the mood of repentance. If you're a poor person and you can't go anywhere or buy anything, there's nothing stopping you from getting into the mood of repentance, to recognizing, yes, I am a sinner, I have this continuity problem. Nothing stopping you. What stops you is to be brainwashed into thinking you need to work harder, make more money, to buy things, and that you're not supposed to say that you're a sinner, you have a severe problem, continuity problem, that you're supposed to be buying things for your happiness. That's the problem. So again, we this world is going what I call into the fourth dimension. The Pope, Pope Francis, is one of the key figures of bringing the world into the fourth dimension. The President of the United States is also another key figure. There are key figures around the world, okay? A lot of people, a lot of leaders of the countries now around the world are key figures in bringing about this new world order of secular humanist materialism. And there's this just an incredible guerrilla campaign against religion, against admitting you're a sinner, which again is admitting you have a severe problem, which is the continuity problem, which everybody has, and providing a culture of repentance. That is the key to your salvation, actually. It is the key. And there is this massive war against that, to wipe it out and replace it with this secular materialistic consumer paradise of redistribution, everybody, you know, all this stuff, and say, now you're happy, don't worry, you don't have to go home, you're happy here. In other words, you don't have to accept the vision of the now as it is and actually experience your true freedom. You don't have to do that. You can just be happy in this consumer, quote unquote, consumer paradise. This is absolute madness, but this is the fourth dimension, the big treasure hunt where everybody is helping one another in their search. Let's all search together. It's kind of like, hey, the reason why we're not finding our treasure, our lost treasure, is because we're not searching together. If we all just hold hands and search together, then we're going to find it. You know, no, you're going to go deeper and deeper and deeper into delusion, because there is no lost treasure. There is no enlightenment. Enlightenment is just the flip side of unenlightenment. There is no unenlightenment either. There's neither. There's only freedom. And it's our desire to be prime creator that led to us thinking we need to defend freedom. But it's again trying to hide the fact that we actually want to get rid of it. So we're the great defenders of it. It doesn't need to be defended. See, we refuse to accept it doesn't need to be defended, because that means we can't attack it, which means we can't be prime creator. We can't change it. It means we can't be prime creator. So we are playing this game of, oh no, we're trying to defend it. So we're trying to find enlightenment apart from it. Apart from freedom, we're trying to find something called enlightenment, happiness. But apart from pure, absolute freedom. Never gonna find that. So, as this world goes into this new world order, which it most certainly is, this is a very bad thing for spiritual aspiration. Look what happened to the Tibetans. Tibetans had probably the highest culture of spiritual aspiration on the planet. Is a way of life there, a way of life. And what happened to them? They had to relocate, didn't they? Into India. Which allowed them to do so. Because India too has a very high culture of repentance. And so they relocated. And they can't go back right now, can they? Not really, don't. Very severe. So, relocation is necessary if you want to keep the culture of true spiritual aspiration, culture of continuity issue, acknowledging you have a problem, and the mood of repentance. If you want to keep that, they call it the Dharma. If you want to keep the Dharma, if you want to keep that culture of spiritual aspiration going, sometimes you do need to relocate. Now we're told that Jesus, quote unquote Jesus, the Christ, the one who knew that everything, that reality needs no defense. That there's this quote unquote coming back for what? For what purpose? To help us sidestep this new world order, actually. Now, the Tibetans, they went into India. But what if the whole globe, this whole planet, is enmeshed in this new world order of secular humanistic materialism and consumerism, which is what is happening. Where do you go then? If the whole globe is that way, where do you go? You go somewhere else. So what we're told, what Jesus told us, is he said, I'm preparing a place for you. So at the end of the age, I'm going to come back and take you to that place. That's directly what he said. He said, this age will come to an end, and it will go into something very, very tough for a while here on this planet. For a while. Don't know how long, but it's going to be very, very, there's an attempt to establish this utopia. The ego is going to make this big push. So he says, I'm going to take you there so you can dwell there. So like the Tibetans, they had to move from their monasteries. They had to leave their monasteries behind in Tibet. They had to, you know, relocate and keep the Dharma going. So it may very well be that those who want to continue on in a culture of genuine spiritual aspiration, mood of repentance, we'll need to relocate. We'll need to sidestep what is taking place in the world. That may very well happen. Now, when? A couple days ago, I suddenly got this like spiritual tweet, as it were, registered in my consciousness. And it is that Jesus, this whole thing is going to happen soon, very soon, within days, actually. Probably start sometime in December. Something actually is going to get started in this direction. This whole plan is going to start happening. I mean, the relocation of the Tibetans didn't happen in one day, right? But it did happen. There were definite exoduses. It wasn't all one mass migration, one mass exodus of everybody left. No, someone went and then someone else, and they set up, you know, it was a pipeline, you know, was established where they were able to get out of the country and relocate, and then reestablish the Dharma, the spiritual culture, the mood of repentance. So we've been told the whole thing's going to happen, poof, everyone's just going to poof. Well, maybe I don't see that exactly happening that way. It could, but I'm not saying that's what's going to happen. I think there'll be an unfolding, like a blossoming of it. But that blossoming, I've been told, is going to start as soon as this December 1st, actually, which is what, tomorrow. There's going to be an unfoldment. It's going to begin, and that quote unquote Jesus is back. Maybe December 1st, maybe Sunday, December 1st. Jesus is back, meaning his plan is now activated. His plan is now activated. And by his plan, that's a reification. I mean, the plan of freedom, Operation Freedom, really, truly, is now going to be activated. Which really is, in Buddhist terms, the Dharma. In Hindu also has the terms, there are various terminologies, which is really just means the culture, the way, the culture, the supportive underpinnings of success on the spiritual path. Those need to be kept going. We have to allow, we cannot put expectations on everybody that they're going to be buying us things. I need to buy everybody gifts. I need to get gifts. I need to get things. I need to work real hard, make a lot of money. I need to entertain people. I need to do this, you know. And I need to take medications, I need to take drugs, I need to keep myself from going mental, I gotta smoke pot, I gotta do all this stuff. Don't need any of that. See, when you have a genuine culture of aspiration, of repentance, you know, the Dharma, then you don't need any of that. It's okay to be glum, to be stunned. It's okay to be stunned. And people won't take advantage of you just because you're stunned. They'll respect it. If you see somebody that you realize that they're in a stunned condition, you respect it. You respect them. They've had a realization. You're like, oh my gosh, I never needed to suffer at all. Oh my gosh, what did I do? You know, how stupid. Oh my gosh, I'm just like unbelievable. How stupid. I can't believe it. You know, they're stunned. It's respected. And given that it's respected, they come out of it. Whereas if it's not respected, what happens? You go mental. And when you go mental, you can't sleep. When you can't sleep, you start taking drugs and anxiety and this and this, and the whole thing snowballs and you become depressed and suicidal and all that kind of stuff. So really the fourth dimension that I call is a suicidal culture, in that everybody's terrified of suicide, so they do everything they can to avoid it. You know, let's be happier, happier, happier. The whole time they're bringing their suicide closer to them. And people eventually become frantic. You know, it's just a horrible, vicious cycle that happens. And in order to escape it, they space everything out. You know, let's go here, let's go there, let's journey here, let's journey that. And they're trying to escape this sense of suicide that's coming towards them. Because they won't allow themselves. There's no dharma. There's no mood of repentance. There's no religious culture that gives them support to say, "Hey, it's okay. We respect you when you're stunned. We respect you. That's okay. You don't need to entertain us. You don't need to get us things. Nobody needs to buy me anything. Yeah. Free people up from having to get you anything. Nobody needs to get me anything." I don't need to get anybody else anything either. So I don't need to be a slave, economic slave. I don't need to. But also, you know, then this mood of repentance, it doesn't bring up, you don't go mental. So you don't get this anxiety. You don't get suicidal, depressed, suicidal. It doesn't happen. So this New World Order is really a pharmaceutical culture, where there's so much money being pumped into the medical and pharmaceutical professions, which are all one, really, that becomes the overall juggernaut of the planet, actually. This is what Jesus said. He said that it's going to be a pharmaceutical world, where pharmaceuticals rule the planet. That's the new religion, the new power is pharmaceuticals and the medical, the whole field of health, therapy, pharmaceuticals, the entire thing. It is the new power on this planet. I don't take a single medication. I've never been, you know, dependent for any period of time on any sort of medication, on nothing. I don't take aspirin, I don't take Tylenol, nothing. I take nothing. And I told somebody that, some medical, and they said, "What?" I remember they took my history or something. Oh yeah, okay. I remember what it was. As someone who deals with a tremendous number of people, patients all the time, and he said, "That's unbelievable. You don't take any. You know, never had a surgery. Never took any medicine." I said, "No." I said, "Super rare." I said, "Super rare." He's like, "Wow." So I'm very stunned to hear that. That just tells you what's going on. Whereas for me, that's totally normal. How could it be any other way? The mood of repentance takes care of you, will take care of you. It was only when that was denied me that I went into depression, you see. So I know what causes depression. You don't see the people of Tibet super depressed and eating all sorts of pharmaceuticals when they were the spiritual culture. You don't see really where the mood of repentance is strong, where there's a strong culture of this. You don't have these kind of problems that we have now in the modern world. So the problem is the whole economic structure is going more and more through this overall global healthcare pharmaceutical thing. It's probably going to be like universal healthcare around the world, which is what they're really going towards. And the whole economic structure will be based on that. So the idea of you don't need any medicines, you don't need any medical care, anything, what is going to be the new blasphemy, and they'll burn you at the stake for having that. And they already are burning. I remember that something like some Amish couple didn't want chemotherapy for their child. They had to flee the country because they were forcing it upon upon the child for leukemia, forcing it. Christian Science is people who are being persecuted because they believe in Christian Science, which is ultimately based on truth, actually, very much so. If someone dies on the operating table, everybody says, "Oh, isn't it a shame?" You know, people are dying constantly in hospitals from treatments, etc. But if a Christian Science treatment happens to not work, as sometimes, you know, this will be the case, it didn't quite do it right or whatever, then they're guilty of murder. But the doctors, the pharmaceuticals, people who die from taking medicines constantly, nothing happens to them. Total double standard. So that just shows you where this culture is going, and Jesus is very aware of this fact, as are all the those who abide in their imperfect freedom, who know that there is no need to defend it. All those, they know what's going on here. So there is some plan to sidestep this situation. Otherwise, especially for those who are very far along, for me, it's inconceivable to go back into the depression, etc. This culture will force depression upon you. Oh, and it will force you to abandon your deep understanding, because it will force you to go mental about it. And then if you have deep understanding and you're forced to go mental about it, then your mind will just implode. I mean, you'll just become suicidal very quickly, actually. So it's a super, super dangerous situation in the world, actually. And those who have accepted that freedom is the only condition that there is or ever will be, they're aware of this. They're aware of how bad these times are, and they have impressed upon me there is a plan to sidestep it. Okay, there is a plan to sidestep it. We just don't have the details, the particulars, which we'd go mental on if we did. Okay, so it's best that we don't know, to tell you the truth. So I'm not digging into it. I'm just staying on my path of repentance, clarity, repentance, the Last Supper, unleavened bread, the wine, unleavened bread, the wine, clarity, repentance, clarity, repentance. Just keep doing that. That's what Jesus told us to do. Just keep doing that. Like a cow chews its cud. That's what we're told. Like a cow chews its cud. We just keep on doing this. Clarity, repentance. And then when the time comes, we'll know the way and we'll be able to take those steps, and it won't be difficult. We'll say, okay, I can do this. Again, because it'll just be clarity, repentance. And we'll adjust each step of the way. We'll just adjust, and we won't expect to be all elated. Oh, we're sidestepping. How wonderful. No, we'll say, how stunning. But I'll let this stunningness, I won't go mental on it, you see? So you won't go mental. That's what I want to say to everyone. If you are doing this clarity, repentance, you won't go mental when these steps are taken. Like, okay, there's this great step being taken. All right, let me just stay sober, solemn and sober. I'm not celebrating it. You know, I'm not going to go mental or emotional on it. I'm just going to say, okay, it is what it is. And it's stunning, so I'm just going to let this stunning, you know, wear off. It's like that. You won't go mental. So I'm not afraid of it. I'm not afraid of it because I know pretty much so I'm not going to go mental on it. But I'm not going to be happy right away either, which is fine. When you realize it's the right thing to do, it's going to lead to ultimate happiness, then you don't have to be happy, you know. When you're taking these steps, you don't really have to say, I'm not worried whether I'm happier now or not. I know it's going to work out great for me. So let's just stay in the mood of repentance. All right. You'll never guess what's next for me. Maybe I'll make a video about it, and maybe you'll see it next. I don't know how it's going to go. So, all right. I hope this has been helpful. And remember, don't expect to be all happy about it. Expect to be a little stunned by it. And then just give yourself time to be kind to yourself. Don't force yourself to be super person. I need to go out and give stuff to everybody, redistribute wealth, and I got to do all this stuff. No, no. Just say, hey, I'm kind of stunned right now, and yeah, I'm a little sluggish, a little stunned. Yeah, it's like, that's okay. That's great. Much respect for that. All right. Very great. That's it for this one.